Ever since the dawn of humanity, humans have looked up to the heavens in hopes of finding answers about the gods, the universe, and life. We have carefully observed the stars, we've calculated their movements, discovered their patterns, and slowly we have begun to understand the secrets of the universe. If you're new here, I'm Darius Cousin and this is Vox of Knowledge. Make sure to subscribe and hit the notification bell because we do have brand new episodes every single Wednesday. And today we're talking about Copernicus, the heliocentric theory, and the history of astronomy. The sky has always been visible from Earth. I mean, the ancient civilizations called it the heavens and looked at it for millennia. This vast unknown, filled with bright stars and galaxies, has been a place of observation ever since the dawn of humanity. The first evidence of this that we have comes from the year 35,000 BC, where we found remnant bone sticks marked in ways indicating a link with the different phases of the moon. The evidence for that comes from the fact that the bones have 29 markings on them, as if they were counting the days it took for the moon to go from new to full, which is about 27 days. Now, a woman's menstrual cycle is also linked to the moon, and scientists think that these bones could have been used to keep track of menstruations, making women the very first astronomers. But we're still not sure. I mean, it's hard to tell when a bone is this old. Plus, some parts of the bone are missing, suggesting that maybe there were more than 29 markings on it originally, which would break down this whole argument. Nonetheless, while this discovery doesn't tell us too much about what the prehistoric people thought about the moon and the sky, it does at least give us confidence that very early on, humans have used the stars to live their life. From prehistory, we now move into history. In Mesopotamia, the land between the rivers where the ancient kingdoms of Sumer, Assyria, and Babylon existed, we find what we can truly call the very first astronomers. We have found documents dating to the year 1200 BC that cataloged the different stars and gave each one its own name. The interesting thing is that these names are mostly written in Sumerian, which indicates that the practice of astronomy probably existed long before 1200 BC, since Sumer is believed to have been the very first civilization, dating as far back as the year 5000 BC. The Sumerians were the first ones to associate their gods to the stars, to divide the circle in 360 degrees, and to use a base 60 numerical system which allowed them to represent large and small numbers with greater ease. Now, although they had made these great discoveries, they had not yet involved mathematics with astronomy. I mean, they were still simple observers. For the next step in our history of astronomy, we have to go to Babylonia itself. The Babylonians, who inherited much of their knowledge from the Sumerians, were the first ones to have used mathematics in relation to the stars and astronomy, at least according to the clay tablets that we found. It is believed that they used mathematical calculations to track the variation in the length of each day as the year goes by. Amongst these centuries of documented celestial phenomena that we have discovered, perhaps the most interesting one was the documented risings of Venus in the sky for about 21 years. This is an important discovery because it is the earliest place in recorded history where we have evidence of humans having clearly distinguished between planets and stars. Now, this is still very, very early in the history of astronomy. I mean, we still haven't talked about Copernicus and the heliocentric theory, but don't worry, we will. First, it's important to understand the steps that humanity took to get there. Now, when you do something repeatedly for centuries, like the Babylonians were doing looking at the sky, you tend to become very good at that said thing. The Babylonians got very good at astronomy and mathematics. Towards the end of their civilization, they had made perhaps the greatest discovery of the time. The moon operated in an 18-year lunar cycle. This is not talking about the moon's orbit, which takes approximately 27 days. This is talking about the inclination of the moon's orbit relative to Earth, which simply means that the moon changes the inclination of its orbit relative to the Earth's equator every 18 years. This discovery was so important that later on the famous astronomer Ptolemy used it to fix the beginning of a new era, since he considered that moment the first time humans had made proper, usable observations about the stars. From the Babylonians, we then pass briefly to the Greeks, where we find a man by the name of Hipparchus. Hipparchus was perhaps the greatest astronomer of antiquity. He used the Babylonian observations to create quantitative models of the sun and the moon's movements. His most famous discovery is that of Earth's precession, which is the fact that Earth not only spins on itself, but also spins at the north and south pole in a small circle over a period of about 26,000 years. This is called axial precession. To make this example a little bit clearer, think of a spinning top. You spin it and it spins on itself. But the top and bottom also wobble a little bit, increasing in rotation until the spinning comes to a full stop. The faster the spinning top spins, the slower the top and bottom parts move. It's the same with the Earth, only on a much larger scale. The spinning top is affected by gravity. Gravity is trying to pull it to one side or another, but the fact that it's spinning so fast, the rotational gravity keeps it straight. The Earth is the same. Its rotation wants to keep it straight, but the gravity of the Moon and the Sun make it wobble at a slight angle. This discovery was huge and was perhaps what inspired our next astronomer, Ptolemy, to come up with his own models of the stars. Now, by that point, astronomers had already discovered 5 planets of our solar system: Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, and Saturn, and they had already created a model of the solar system. The most obvious thing about this model is that the Earth is at the center of the solar system. They did this because to them, from Earth's perspective, looking at the stars, it seems like Earth is stationary and that everything else is moving in a circle around the planet, which, I mean, if you don't know any better, makes total sense. This model also put every planet on a circular, not elliptical, orbit around Earth. They used circles because they interpreted these planets as heavenly bodies, and that anything heavenly should be perfect, thus it should be a circle. Because a circle is perfectly round, it symbolized perfection. This model was a good start, but there were some problems. It couldn't accurately account for some of the planets appearing to move backwards in the sky at some points in the year. I mean, take Mars for example. We see a natural orbit, but then suddenly it looks like Mars is moving backwards, doing a sort of small loop, only to continue moving forward again. This is strange, but it's something that we have discovered to be totally normal. We call it retrograde motion. The model of simple circular orbits wasn't enough to explain such a phenomenon. Ptolemy was faced with a problem. How could he explain these retrograde motions? It was a hard thing to explain, but he came up with a clever idea. He modified the model to include something called an epicycle. An epicycle can be simply thought as a circle within a circle. Instead of having Mars orbit Earth in a perfect circle, it orbited Earth on its own little circle within its bigger circle. Ptolemy used that to try to explain Mars's motion in the sky. It worked, but to some degree. Epicycles did improve the model and more accurately represented the retrograde motions, but they were still not perfect. The more precise you wanted to be, the more epicycles you had to add, and eventually, the whole system became way too complicated. As broken as the system was, it somehow survived well into the Middle Ages and even all the way up to the Renaissance, which is kind of strange because this model was broken. Like, if you tried to calculate the position of Mars, you would be a few degrees off. But I mean, there were also some other reasons for the model being adopted and kept for so long. One notable reason is the fact that the church really liked the half-Earth at the center of the universe, because it fit perfectly with the idea that if God made the universe and the stars, he would put Earth at the center of it all, with everything else revolving around it. And when the church adopts an idea like that, it can be very hard to go against it. After about 1300 years of geocentrism, which is a fancy word for Earth being at the center, we finally have somebody who challenges this old, broken view of the universe, Copernicus. Copernicus was a Renaissance-era mathematician and astronomer who proposed that the Earth was not at the center of the universe, but rather that it was orbiting the Sun along with all the other planets. This is what we call the heliocentric theory. But Copernicus wasn't the first one to introduce such an idea. This idea of the Sun being at the center had been around since the ancient Greeks, but due to the strong movement of the Ptolemaic model, the theory never gained much traction until later on. Copernicus realized that the retrograde motions of the planets could be explained much better and without the need for epicycles if the Earth was orbiting the Sun rather than the other way around. It also provided with much better celestial predictions, which convinced him that his model was right and that Ptolemy was wrong. Being a smart guy, he knew that if he went ahead and published his findings, he'd most likely face death by the church. I mean, the church would consider this heresy, going against God himself, so he didn't say anything. Not wanting to take his knowledge with him to the grave, Copernicus decided to finally publish his findings very close to his death. In fact, the very day he died was the day that his book was first published. He saw the first ever copy and then died that same day. What a kind of perfect ending to his life. Unfortunately, this book was largely ignored for about 80 years until a man by the name of Galileo Galilei took up an interest in planetary motion. Galileo had done something no other human had done before him. He built for himself a telescope. Now, he didn't invent the telescope, but he greatly improved it and designed it to allow him to observe the stars in a way that had never been possible before. He was able to magnify the image up to 30 times what the human eye could see, and with it, he saw the different phases of Venus, which served as proof that Copernicus was right. In the old model, Venus's orbit is entirely between the Sun and the Earth, making it impossible to see Venus fully lit as it would have to somehow be behind Earth. On Copernicus's model, however, this was possible. It was the first time somebody could actually provide some tangible proof to the model. Around the same time, a German mathematician by the name of Johannes Kepler was working on another piece of the puzzle. Copernicus's model was good, but it had some fundamental flaws. For one, it was using circles, perfect circles, as orbits instead of ellipses, which, of course, if you can imagine, gave rise to a lot of problems. Kepler was very lucky that he had access to a ton of observations made by the Danish astronomer Tycho Brahe, most notably his observations of Mars's motion throughout the sky. While Copernicus added more and more epicycles to his model to explain irregularities, Kepler realized that they could all be explained if the planets orbited in ellipses instead of circles, and he could do it without the need for epicycles. He used the data from Brahe about Mars and realized that Mars's movements would only make sense if it moved in an elliptical orbit. This orbit, combined with the orbit of the Earth, would explain perfectly why we see Mars's retrograde motion in the sky. Kepler was able to prove these orbits were elliptical, but he wasn't able to explain why they were like that. The final man who was able to find the missing link was none other than Isaac Newton himself. Newton used Kepler's laws and observations to deduct his own laws of the universe that proved planets would move in elliptical orbits. He was able to provide mathematical proof and argue that if his equations are correct, then the orbits had to be elliptical. And of course, today we all know that Newton's laws are correct. In fact, they are so correct that they have become the foundation for modern physics. These laws became universal and are said to affect the entirety of the universe. The puzzle was finally complete, and the solar system was finally understood. Whoa, that was a ton of knowledge for one video. If you've enjoyed the video, please make sure to leave it a big thumbs up, subscribe, hit the notification bell, join Team Knowledge, and be notified whenever I release a new video. And now it's time for questions. Do you like astronomy? What is your favorite cool fact about the universe that you would like to share? Please do leave me a comment. I would love to read and answer them all. And bonus points for you, if you do leave a comment, you might get featured in next week's video as a fan of the week. As you know, and as I say at the end of every video, I haven't talked about everything regarding Copernicus, the heliocentric theory, and the history of astronomy. That's okay. I'm actually doing this on purpose to get you guys to research more on your own. Because I believe in research, and I believe in getting you guys educated on a subject. And if you want to learn more, as always, there'll be some links in the description where you can start. With that being said, my name has been Darius Kazin. It's been an absolute pleasure. You can follow me on social media. The links will also be in the description. And I will see you all next Wednesday.